Are you reeling in the yeast? Stowing away the time.
Oh, Steely Dan was reeling in the years. Eleri with you here on BBC Radio Wales. Film Friday coming up. But first, it's time for Foodie Friday. And joining me in our virtual Radio Wales kitchen today is Lisa Fearn from the Pumpkin Patch Kitchen and Garden at a Shed in Carmarthen. Shumai?
Shumai, Eleri.
How are you?
Long time.
Yes.
I'm fine, thank you very much.
It's a bit of a mouthful, the Pumpkin Patch Kitchen and Garden at a Shed in Carmarthen.
You can just call us a shed, it's fine. We started off as a Pumpkin Patch Kitchen and Garden probably back in 2008, so it's a while back now. Primarily a cookery school for children, and it was a pretty catchy, bright, fun name. And then almost three years ago, we renovated an old cowshed, and at that point, we became At a Shed. So that's how it's all come about. And of course, some people now know us as the Pumpkin Patch still, and kids still love that. But as a cookery school, we are now a shed and cafe.
But it's a very posh shed. Can we just say
it's a comfortable shed.
It's a comfortable shed. So a little birdie tells me, and this is a very loaded question, that you've been shopping recently. What have you been out buying?
Oh, yes. Well, something I never thought in a million years I would buy.
What?
I bought a horse box. A horse box. It looks like one of the old rice horse boxes.
Right. So I presume you're not going to stick a horse in there.
No, I do you know what? I wouldn't know one end of a horse from the other. Well, I probably would, just about, but I would.
You would
not
if something happened, if it was that time of day, yeah.
I appreciate them as beautiful animals, but I won't ever own a horse, I can assure you. So, the purpose of it being to create a mobile shed, which we'll probably call a box, because it is a horse box. We like a box, a shed,
that.
And we hope to be selling bubble tea in Carmarthen, which we don't yet have, and I love bubble tea.
Bubble tea? What's
You're
bubble?
Tell me now that you've never heard of it.
I've never heard of bubble tea. Are we talking, is it a dash of Prosecco or something mixed in with this tea?
No, that might make a very, very interesting bubble tea.
Yeah.
But no, it's generally a jasmine or a green or black tea flavoured with fruit, sometimes fruit concentrate, other times actual fruit pulp, and then tapioca pearls or popping pearls are put in it. It's a sort of an Asian origin, and it really is delicious. You can have sort of, you know, a normal sugared variety or a low sugar variety, and you can also have little jelly bits put in and various bits and bobs. It's really refreshing. I just love, imagine, the closest I can describe the tapioca pearls is, you know, those little gummy bears?
Yes.
Those little teeny gummy bears. Imagine teeny little gummy bears in a drink. So you've got the nice, refreshing, cold, iced, by the way, iced drink.
Right.
And then you've got these little chewy bits in there, which come up a rather large straw. So it's almost a drink and a dessert in one.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, now the jury is out until I taste this. I'm just imagining, because my father comes down to Carmarthen on a regular basis. I don't know if my dad would stop at the box to have a bubble tea, but I will bring him. And you are there then to change both our attitudes towards tea. Right, listen, something else you've been involved with is this project. Yeah. You've been helping businesses to adapt to life post-lockdown. So what have you been doing with them?
Well, it's quite strange because, you know, it's been two years now and more, hasn't it, where businesses have been working or people have been working from home, and the people haven't seen each other. They've seen their pictures on a screen. But, you know, you turn up for your Zoom meeting, you enjoy, hopefully, your Zoom meeting, and then it's goodbye. There's no chit-chat, there's no cup of tea, there's no, you know, enjoying a biscuit together for just 5 or 6 minutes afterwards. And although you could argue that's a waste of business time, that networking time, not getting to know each other time, is really important, especially if you want to be happy in your role and all of that. So we've been getting businesses together to come to a shed. They have a bit of fun. They arrive, let's have a nice cup of tea or coffee, piece of cake, and then we sort of give them a fun cookery sort of exercise class, whatever you want to call it, demonstration if they don't want to get their hands dirty, and they just enjoy being in a shed, relaxing, having a chat, having a laugh. And then if they choose to, it's not always the case, they can have a little meeting afterwards and sort of, you know, bring the day to a close with something a bit more sort of business-like.
Okay, I had a vision of everybody within the office, right, having to get down and dirty and share that kitchen. And then I would not be able to do that because I have to do that sometimes with my husband. And I become the... how should I say? He becomes the master and I am the gopher. Oh, can you pass me that? Can you pass? And that gets under my skin. If you want to use it, come and get it yourself, because I am in the zone doing something. You know what I mean? So
yes,
have you had any people arguing across the worktop?
No, we haven't. I think we've had interesting characters, and you know, some people are more forceful with their views and their recipes than others. But generally, it's a bit of fun.
Okay.
Tomorrow morning, I've got a hen do, for instance. That's going to be a bit of fun. That should be interesting. At 9:15 tomorrow morning. I don't know whether the prosecco will be flowing that early, but we shall see.
I've got a feeling it will be. Right then, let's park that for a moment, and your shed, of course, because we are going to be delving into two recipes today, I've already revealed them, but just very quickly, give us the titles.
Well, we've got a spring green risotto with nice honey sweetened chorizo, and then we've got some really sticky buns with pecan and apricot. like Chelsea buns with pecan and apricot.
I'm in. Right, stay where you are. We'll be back with you shortly. Lisa Fearn, remember, if you want to get your hands on these recipes, you need to email us, eleri@bbc.co.uk, and we'll pop them into your inbox by 5 o'clock today. Right, we'll be back after Marillion and Kaylee. Marillion and Kaylee. Right then, we are in the Foodie Friday kitchen and we are with Lisa Fearn today, who is about to tell us how to make a spring green risotto with honey sweetened chorizo, or chorizo, I think.
Well, chorizo, it doesn't matter. I was always taught chorizo. My mother and father used to live in Spain for some of the year, and they always said, I think the Z is in Spanish. If anybody knows better, let me know.
Okay. Well, listen, it tastes the same, however you say it.
It does.
On then. Not many ingredients in this, which I absolutely love. So just whiz through the ingredients very quickly, and where do we start?
Well, you need risotto rice, arborio rice, which is a round rice, which sort of creams up quite nicely in a stock.
Could you get away with going for a basmati rice or any rice you've got in the cupboard, but maybe cook it for less time?
You'd get away with maybe a pudding rice, but you don't really want the long grains. You want the rounder grains. They sort of create a much silkier, smooth sauce. I think the starch content must be higher, and so you create that not soup exactly, but it's a sauce that coats the grain rather than like a basmati or a long grain rice where it's a lot more fluffy, isn't it?
I understand.
It's never going to fluff up the same.
Okay, fabulous.
So you do need arborio rice, or it might just say a risotto rice, just a little butter to give flavour. Then you need a lot of stock, about a litre of vegetable or chicken stock or fish stock if you're going to make it a fishy dish or whatever. A cup of white wine, just to add a bit of flavour. And then the base of the risotto is going to be onion or shallots and some celery and garlic. And then anything other than that, really, it can be up to you.
Okay.
You know, you can add whatever spring greens you like. I've used some spring onions. I've also used, they're not green at all, but a handful of radish sliced really thinly, or a mandolin if you have one, but be careful. And then maybe some asparagus spears, or you can even put some pea shoots through, or anything like that. And then maybe some cheese, just to make it nice and cheesy and rich at the end. So I've got about 75 grams of grated parmesan.
Fab. And we'll come to the chorizo in the moment.
Yeah,
then.
We'll come to that in a bit. Yeah, yeah.
So where do we start with this?
Well, to start with, make up your stock. So I assume somebody's going to use a stock cube or one of the little sachets. Make up about a litre of stock, and chop your onions or your shallots and celery really finely, and pop them in a pan with some butter and a drop of oil. And you start frying them. You don't want to colour them. You just want to heat them through so they become translucent and soft. And then once they've reached that soft stage, you can add a little bit of garlic, as much as you like to taste, really. You don't want to add it too soon or it could burn. So you just add it when the onion is just right. And then you can go straight in with your cup of wine. So you allow the wine to just evaporate off and cook off, which gets rid, of course, the alcohol, but you'll retain the flavour of the wine in the onions. And then, really, you can add the 2 cups of rice, and then you can just gradually keep adding the stock. So all you're doing is keeping everything moving. You don't let the rice sit at the bottom of the pan. You move everything, the celery, the onion, the rice around. And every time it gets a little bit dry, you add another ladleful of the stock, until eventually the stock is used up, and you should then have a rice which is cooked to perfection on the outside and just a teeny weeny bit nutty on the middle, in the middle.
Right. Can I stop you for one moment?
Yeah.
All right.
You might.
This is what puts people off from making risotto, because it is a process.
Yeah.
You've got to stand by the old cooker for 20 to 25 minutes. So the other day I found a recipe that didn't need adding the stock a ladle at a time. They said put all the stock in at once and stir it every few minutes. And it was fine.
Okay, so I'll agree, you can add more stock than you let on, but the tendency then is to walk away, the rice will settle at the bottom and you won't come back every 2 to 3 minutes.
Okay.
That is the potential problem. You don't want it to sit, you see, you want to keep it moving.
All right.
But I agree, you can add two ladlefuls at a time, and you can, you know, obviously you can walk away for 2 seconds, well, a minute and come back, but don't do it if you're like me and you have a tendency to run upstairs, forget you've got anything cooking, make a bed or two and then come back down, do you know what I mean? You've got to be with it.
Maybe another pointer is just, pour yourself another glass of wine to stand there and drink and watch.
Well, exactly. Yeah, well, there is that. You've opened a bottle of wine and there's always the radio, isn't
there?
You can listen to something.
Yes.
You know?
Right, okay. So the rice is ready. Sorry, I digress.
The rice is ready.
What's next?
During the few minutes you've nipped away from your pan and you've stopped stirring, you could have chopped up some spring onions and a handful of radish. You might have steamed some asparagus or gone to your fridge and got whatever you've got left in the bottom of that drawer that needs using up. So we call it spring green. If you wanted to add peppers, you could add peppers. If you've got things you really need to use up, use them. Don't waste them. Mange two sugar snap peas, any of that sort of thing. Chop them up. And then what you're going to do is just, once they're all about the same, like let's say a centimetre and a half long, pour them into your risotto, stir them through. So the heat of the risotto and the rice now is going to cook those. Not fully. They're going to be a little bit crunchy, which I think is lovely. The radish is going to retain that nice pink colour on the rim. And then you're just going to stir through your Parmesan cheese, season it with salt and pepper, and it is done. So although you stood there for 25 minutes, that is all it takes to make the dish. So really, it's not too bad.
Yeah, there's not much prep. So come on then, let's talk about chorizo. How simple is this, or how complicated?
It's so simple and it's so delicious. Chorizo is delicious as it is because it retains, it's got all that flavour of red wine, garlic, paprika, loads of spices. So it's really nice. And it's a quick way of adding a good burst of flavour into any savoury dish. So what you're going to do, chop them into nice, such as 1 centimetre slices, pop them in a small frying pan with a little bit of olive oil, and just over a low heat, let the oils come out of the chorizo. And then when they're all sort of, you turn them over, once they're slightly sort of just a little bit cooked, add in a good dollop of honey. And that will just sizzle up around them and coat them in the most delicious sweetness. And that is it. You then dribble that sort of oily honey all over your risotto on the plate. You can serve it up, put the risotto in a bowl, add the chorizo and the oil and the honey on top, and it is absolutely delicious.
Oh, it sounds beautiful. Producer Julie, she's salivating in front of me. Oh, I love that, she said. I have to agree with her. It's absolutely brilliant. Okay, stay where you are, right? Because we've got more. We've got pecan, apricot and honey buns. They're sticky buns, okay? We'll be back with Lisa Fearn shortly, but now it's time for a traffic and travel update. Okay? Right, Lisa Fearn is with us and she has just made a delicious spring green risotto with honeyed chorizo sprinkled on top. Oh! Remember, email us. We'll send the recipe into your inbox by 5 o'clock today. Email address to come. But now, let's talk something sweet. Oh, I love the sound of this. Pecan, apricot and honey buns. They look straightforward as well. Where do we start with these?
Well, to start with, imagine a Chelsea bun. Yeah. So you know exactly what we're aiming to have in terms of look, okay? So it's going to be a swirly sort of bun. But instead of the usual currant mix that we have in a Chelsea bun, we're going to put apricot and pecans in there and the sweetness of lovely honey again. So what we're going to do, we're going to make a bread. We're going to make a slightly enriched dough. So anybody who makes bread regularly will know that, you know, you start off with a strong bread flour. Don't go for self-raising or plain. It has to be strong because that contains a higher percentage of protein called gluten, and that's what allows the dough to become nice and springy and elastic and hold the carbon dioxide in there as the little bubbles. So it has to be strong. So you need about 500 grams of strong bread flour. And then you want a teaspoonful of salt, which is odd, I know. When you make sweet buns, I always feel it's a bit weird saying put salt in.
But the
tongue still needs to have that little bit of saltiness, okay, to make it sort of a happy feeling when you're eating them. So a teaspoon of salt, and then about a tablespoonful of sugar. So we're going to have a nice sweet dough. And then we're going to have, did I say yeast?
No.
I use dried yeast. So I buy a little tin of Allinson's dried yeast. It lasts for ages in the cupboard. It's a perfect little amount, and it's got a plastic top on it, so you can keep it in the cupboard. It's a great standby, And even if you bake regularly, it's good to have that in the cupboard. If you run out of sort of fresh yeast, if you use that, you've always got a backup plan.
Yeah.
And then we're going to put a little bit of butter. So you can add butter, olive oil actually, just a little bit of oil, a tablespoon of oil or sort of a tablespoonful of butter, which you then rub in. And then you're going to bring it all together with 300 mils of warm milk. Now, the yeast that we've put in needs to be activated, so and it needs to be a happy yeast so that it starts breathing, starts respiring and giving off the carbon dioxide. So we're going to add warm milk, a bit of a shock to get into a cold bath, isn't it? So we don't want that for the yeast. We want to keep put him in a warm bath, make him happy.
Right.
So warm milk, and then he's going to wake up nicely and happily, and he's going to start this breathing, and that is what's going to make our bread nice and light and fluffy. So once you've brought all this together into a dough, we need to knead it to strengthen the dough. So you need to push it and pull it. You can thump it. You can flip it on the worktop. Whichever way you like to knead your dough, you knead for about 5 to 6 minutes, and you'll feel the texture starting to change. It gets a lot more elastic and a lot more smooth as well. And once you've reached that stage, you can pop it back in the bowl and let it be for about an hour to rest.
Okay, so an hour to rest. So this is not a quick
one.
Okay, you've got
to... So it's not a quick one, but it, you know, the cooking time, you're only talking maybe 10 minutes to do what I've just said, and then you walk away for an hour.
Okay,
then
that's
you come
good.
Back to it. Yeah, come back to it, tip it out on a floured surface, and then roll it out flat as though you're making a big pizza. And this is where you warm up some honey if it's a firm honey. You basically want a runny honey. But if you haven't got that, warm a little bit of honey in a saucepan until it warms up and becomes runny again. And then you can paint on the honey onto the dough. So you've created a nice sticky layer of honey on the dough.
Right.
And then sprinkle on chopped up pecan nuts and apricots.
Yeah.
Obviously, you can substitute those two for anything you like. You could use cranberries. You can use the normal currants if you want to. But pecan and apricot, it's a little bit different, and it's a bit more spring-like, isn't it, with the apricot colour.
So basically, you're looking at the dough now that you've rolled out in the shape of a pizza, and you're putting your toppings on. That's what you're doing
here. Yeah, exactly like you're making a pizza.
All right.
And then you just roll it up, okay? Roll it up into a large sausage. And sort of squidge it up a little bit to make sure there's no air bubbles in there. Keep it nice and firm. And then all you're going to do is slice, I would say, 2.5 centimetre slices of the sausage and put it swirly side up in an oiled tin.
Okay.
Exactly like you would a Chelsea bun.
Yeah.
So you want to be able to see the swirls of the apricot and the pecans and the honey. Because, you know, as you cut through the sausage, you'll reveal the pattern that you've just created by rolling up the dough.
Of course. And I suppose these are going to be quite small at the beginning.
Yeah, they are. They're going to be quite small. But so give them a little bit of space as well, because they are going to prove. So we've rested it for an hour. We're now going to let it prove for about half an hour, and they will end up touching. And at that point, then you just give them a glaze of egg and milk or egg and water and pop them in the oven for half an hour, 25 minutes to half an hour. And they'll come out golden brown and absolutely delicious. And the smell in the room will be rather divine as well.
Oh, my, it's as simple as that. Nothing. I've always looked at a Chelsea bun and thought, oh, that's too much of a job. But this sounds absolutely straightforward. You could be making your pizza and then you could be making your sticky buns at the same time. I love this.
Exactly, you
could you use that then? Could you use the same dough for your pizzas?
Well, if I was to do this, if I was to make the same dough for the pizza and these, I wouldn't put the sugar in.
Oh,
so
you've brilliant.
Got a plain bread.
Yeah.
So, you know the current, but you know the buns you get, the ice buns, which have just a normal unsweetened, I think, bread, but with icing on top. You could just do exactly the same. So you could roll half of it out to make a pizza, roll the other half out, because the sweetness comes from the honey anyway and the fruit. So exactly, it's exactly the same. Exactly. So then to make it ultra sticky at the end, another glaze of the honey, the runny honey on top. And if you want to, you can sprinkle some more pecans on top as well.
Oh, my gosh. Well, my weekend has just got better. Lisa Fearn, diolch o galon. Absolutely beautiful. Have a brilliant time and have fun in the box.
Thank you very much.
Pob luck.
See you soon.
Okay, ta-ra, you take care. And of course, you can get your hands on Lisa Fearn's recipes today. Oh my gosh, this spring green risotto with honeyed chorizo, or it's a friend of chorizo. And of course, these sticky buns, beautiful. Email us now, eleri@bbc.co.uk, and we'll send the recipes into your inbox by 5 o'clock today.